Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord our God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the Lord our God. Hallelujah. He's worthy to be praised. Glory be to the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. We welcome you this day to the Sign of the Dove Church. Hallelujah. Where we are spirit-led and compassion-driven. I'm just so excited to be in the house this morning. I'm so excited to be with you, those that have joined us on social media. We want you to know that the Lord loves you. We want you to know that the Lord is concerned about you. Hallelujah. And so this is the day that the Lord has made. And so let us rejoice and be glad in it. There's another day that God has woke you up. There's another day that God has given you breath in your body. And so this is a day to give him thanks. This is a day to rejoice in who he is, to bless the Lord. And so let the people of God begin to bless the Lord. Let the people of God begin to exalt him. Let the people of God begin to make his name great. Make his name great in your bedroom. Make his name great in your kitchen. Make his name great in the dining room. Make his name great in your bedroom. Make his name great in your car. Make his name great. Father, we bless you this morning. Hallelujah. We give your name all the praise. You are worthy to be exalted, O God. Father, I thank you, Lord God, that you surround us with songs of victory, O God. I thank you, Lord God, that you are God who hears us when we cry. I thank you, Lord God, that there is nothing too difficult for you. I thank you, O God, that you answer the prayers of your children, O God. I thank you, Father, that you do not leave us comfortless, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, that you are a comforter, O God. Hallelujah. 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 Be with us in this place today, oh God. Be with us today, oh God. Hallelujah. Be with everyone that's on this call. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Somebody clap your hands and thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody clap your hands and thank the Lord. Come on now. Hallelujah. We're going to lift up the name of the Lord today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We got to look back and realize what he's done. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Here we go. Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Our God saves.
Our God saves.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Highest praises.
Highest praises.
Thanks. Come on, somebody say,
thanks.
I'm grateful.
I'm grateful for who you are and all you've done.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Come on now.
Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Oh, my soul.
Oh, my soul cries, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for saving me.
Come on, somebody. We're going to thank the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. As you look back over your life, you got to give him a hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Our God saves.
Our God saves.
Oh, hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Highest praises.
Highest praises.
Oh, thanks. Come on, somebody. I'm grateful.
I'm grateful
for who you are and all you've done. Look back. Yeah, yeah. Gotta look back And it takes you to another place of being able to worship when you recognize what he's done in your life. Hallelujah. A praise cries out and says, you've been so good. You've been so good. I thank you, Lord. I thank you. My heart is full. My heart is full. I love you, Lord. I love you. Hallelujah. The Bible says that when we think about his goodness, we need to give him praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We remember how good you are. You are good to your people. You are a good God. We bless you this morning. We bless you this morning. And Father, we wait on you. Father, whatever place we're in right now, Father, we wait on your presence. Hallelujah. We wait on your presence, Lord. We need your presence, oh God. Hallelujah. We need your presence, Lord. That's why we're waiting for our God. You're our God, and you hear, and you listen, and you deliver. Come on, somebody.
If faith can move the mountains, let the mountains move. And we've come with expectation, waiting here for you.
That's why we're here, God.
Waiting here for you.
My God.
You're the Lord of all creation, and still you know my heart. The author of salvation, you love me from the start.
Let's sing it together. Waiting here.
Waiting here for you, with our hands lifted high in praise. And it's you we adore. Faithfulness is true, and we're desperate, and we're desperate for your presence.
All we need is you.
All we need is you.
All we need is you, Lord. All we need, we're waiting.
Waiting here for you.
With our hands,
one more time. Come on, open it up, open it up. We're going to sing it one more time.
Waiting here.
Waiting here for you.
With our hands.
With our hands.
My soul sings hallelujah, 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 singing, singing,
come on, somebody give him the highest praise. Come on, come on, bring it up. Come on.
Hallelujah.
Come on, sing it out. Come on, give him a high praise.
Hallelujah.
Come on, give him high praise.
Hallelujah.
Come on, cry out with praise.
Hallelujah.
With high praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
here in your presence, Lord. Here in your presence, Lord. We wait in your presence. We wait in your presence. We wait in your presence. We wait in your presence.
Waiting for you.
You meet us there.
Waiting for you.
You meet us there.
You meet us there.
You speak tenderly.
Waiting for you.
You draw us near.
You draw us near.
You draw us near.
You draw us near.
Come closer. Come
closer to your
heart. We draw near to you. We draw near to you. We draw near to your presence, Lord. You're what I need. You're what I need. We get back to that place. Get back to that place. Right where you are, right where you are. Thank you, Jesus. Right where you are. Where my heart is surrendered. Where my heart is given over to you. Well, you will come and meet me in my brokenness. Father, I'm broken. And drawing near to your presence, I'm made whole. I give you my life. I give you my trust, Jesus. And you are my God. And you are enough, Jesus. I'll say it again, Jesus. Somebody that'll say, I'll give you my life. Come on. I give you my life. I give you my trust. Come on, say his name, Jesus. And you are my God.
And you are my God.
My God. Hallelujah.
You are enough,
Jesus.
Jesus.
Somebody sing again,
Jesus.
I hope we can make this declaration. My heart is yours. My heart is yours. Take it all. Take it all. My life's in your hands. Yes, Lord. Come on, I lay down my life.
I lay down my life. I take up my cross.
Somebody sing, Jesus. And you are my God,
for you are my God. Whatever the cost,
Jesus. Come on, somebody.
It's
the
the name that delivers, Jesus.
I will ever love and trust you in your presence. I will
all to Jesus,
all to Jesus.
Come on and sing with us. Come on and sing this unto the Lord. Right there. In your presence I will live. That's where I need to be. It's in your presence, Lord. That's where I need to be. Every day, Lord, living in your presence. See, I am free in your presence. I'm free in your presence. I'm free. Oh my God, I'm free. I am free. I'm free
in your presence.
Yes, Lord.
I'm free in your presence.
You make me whole.
In your presence.
You give me what I need.
In your presence.
I am free.
I'm free in your presence.
I am free. You're what I need. All the weight, all the anxiety, everything that goes on in this life. You are what I need. Father, forgive us for giving our hearts to other things that cannot change anything. Father, forgive us, Lord God, for laying our hearts to people, to relationships, to money, to education, laying our hearts to these things. You desire our hearts, oh God, that we would move from this place of stoniness and move to this place of the fleshly soft heart. That would beat the beat of righteousness. A heart that's wholly set apart for you. A heart that's given over to you. Given over to your presence, Lord. Given over to your lordship. Lead me, Lord, in your way. Lead me, Lord. Lead me in your righteousness, oh. Father, I pray, Lord God, for surrender to overwhelm everyone today. That our hearts would be given over to you. That we would make it a habitation for you. That everything else has to move out the way so that the King of Glory would come in. The Bible says, let the stones be moved so that the King of Glory can come in. Make the road ready. Prepare the road for the King of Glory to come in. Father, we prepare our hearts for your great procession. To come and take your throne right here. Come and take your throne right here in us. That you are Lord over our lives. That you are Lord over anxiety right now. That you are Lord over the brokenness right now. That you are Lord over defeat and failure right now, my God. That you are the Lord that makes us whole. Father, I pray for everyone that is feeling defeated right now, that they would stand and see the salvation of the Lord. That they would look up, that the King of Glory is in. Who is the King of Glory? The Lord strong and mighty. He is the Lord, mighty in battle. He is for you. He is for you. So you don't have to fear. You don't have to fear. He is for you. Take refuge in Him. He is for you. Take refuge in Him. Run to the rock. The rock, Christ Jesus, run to the rock. Oh God, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Father, I pray for the drawing of your presence right now, the drawing of your presence, that people would draw right now in the name of Jesus, coming near to your presence, Lord God. Father, bowing down before you, Lord God, and crying and crying before you, Lord God, and making their request known before you, oh God, because you are God who hears. Father, in the midst of us being in your presence, Lord God, I pray for a whole surrender unto you. My heart is yours.
My heart is yours. Take it all. Take it all. My life in your hands.
Just right where you are, just sing it.
My heart is yours. My heart is yours.
Take it all.
Take it all.
Take it all.
Take it all.
It's a jump of faith, it's a jump of just jumping in. No, you don't know what it looks like, but God will uphold you. I'm a living witness. God will meet you right where you are. All He's looking for is a yes. Yes, I surrender. Yes, I surrender. Yes, I give up. I'm tired. My God. I give up. I give up. I give up all to you. I give it all to you. My God. My God. My God. Come unto me, all ye who are weary. Rest. That's what the Lord Jesus says today. Come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Thank you, Father. Father, we pray for the ground to be prepared right now, for the word of God to come forth. Father, we pray for Pastor Jason, Lord God. Bless him, Lord God. Father, as he opens his mouth, Lord God, may the words come from the throne room. We love you, Father. We thank you for hearing us today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Come on and clap your hands and rejoice. Clap your hands and rejoice, for the Lord is good. Hallelujah.
Amen. The Lord is good. Amen. Amen. It's great to be back with you all, and I welcome you again, and especially welcome those of you who may be watching our online service for the very first time. We want you to know we love you with the love of the Lord, and we're grateful that you're spending some time with us today. We're going to jump right in and dig into the Word of God this morning. You know, it's great when we have this time to begin in worship and to sort of set our hearts and surrender to God and be reminded of his goodness and be reminded of our need for him. And it really sort of sets us in position now to kind of go from what we just sang and where we were praying, and now we're asking God to speak to us even more directly through his word and his truth that has the power to change us. Amen. So, Father, we just give you this time again. Have your way. Move by your power, Holy Spirit. Use your word of truth today to change us, to conform us to your ways, to make us more like you, to encourage us, to strengthen us. God, all those things that only your word can do, let it move in and through us today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want us to think about, I don't know if there's moments that you have in your life when you respond to someone in ways that you're not always the most proud of, right? I mean, I'll admit that there's times where maybe with my wife or with my kids or, shoot, maybe it's the dog or maybe it's your coworker or your classmate. Sometimes when we're a little frustrated or a little irritated and we've lost our patience, we don't always act as godly as we would like to. Amen? Now, I say that because I know we all can relate to those moments. Right, where anger gets the best of us and we kind of lash out in ways that we know we shouldn't. And sometimes it's just the momentary issue and, you know, you just kind of lost your cool because there was a sequence of things. And other times it's the reality that there's stuff that's been building up for a while. And you finally sort of reach that boiling point and you know, it sort of boils over and you lash out in person, or maybe you post something on social media that it just kind of reached that point. And I was thinking about it, like, I know we have those moments, but for some of us, this entire year has kind of been a sequence of those moments where there's been a trial, a struggle, a hardship that's lasted for some of us now for months. Right, whether it's dealing with the isolation because of the pandemic or dealing with how people have been sick or have passed away or how people have lost jobs, financial situations have been impacted, relationships have been impacted. For many of us, this whole year has just been a year in a lot of ways that's been characterized by trials and by struggles. And so it seems like now that we're in December, this last month of 2020, it's a time, a moment for us to pause and really reflect and say, okay, God, all this has been going on. There's been a lot of trial, a lot of struggle. How have I handled it? How have I responded? So I want us to think about this today, like truthfully, if I were to ask you, as you reflect, would you be able to say that through these trials and struggles this year that you've matured in your faith? That you have persevered and you've seen yourself develop deeper character and deeper intimacy with God, and you've seen him use you to encourage and bless and strengthen other people. Would that be the big takeaway? Or if you're honest, would you be able to say, you know, I think I'm actually struggling more at the end of the year than where I started. If I look back, I can see, man, I did this that I wasn't so proud of, and I've been acting in this way that I really know that I shouldn't, or I fell back into this temptation or this sin, or there's this been thing that's been weighing on me, and truthfully, I can't really say that I'm closer to God. In fact, maybe I'm further away, and maybe I'm acting less righteously and more selfishly. I mean, what would we say? How have we responded to the trials of this year? I want us to turn today to the letter from James. And we're going to spend some time just in a portion of the first chapter of James. And just to set a little context for what James is speaking to this early church, these early churches, and it still speaks true to us today. There's a couple themes he's kind of starting into even as he begins in this first chapter. Because he's dealing with these trials and temptations that they faced. And in many similar ways, we still face trials and temptations in our lives, and so much more, it feels like, even this year. But there's a couple things we got to understand even about these trials. See, what's interesting is that trials present an opportunity. They can be moments of testing that develop perseverance in our faith and produce maturity and growth, or they can be moments of temptation that lead us down a path towards sin, which ultimately wants to lead us towards a path of death and destruction and separation from God. So trials can be good and they're growing us, and or they can be negative in the ways that they pull us away from God. And James is encouraging them, like, look, you need to face these trials with the right attitude. Because sometimes when we go through a trial, what we really want, what we really pray for is, God, just get me out of it. Remove the struggle. Take it away from me. Let me feel safe and comfortable again. But what James is beginning to speak to and challenging them here, and I want to bring this challenge to us today, is not to primarily focus on praying for safety or comfort and get out of the struggle. But he's saying, no, what's most important is that you stay pure in the midst of that struggle, in the midst of that trial, that you're still able to live courageously and righteously. And he's basically telling them, and we need to think of it this way, that the reality is, look, you should hate sin more than you hate the suffering that a trial produces. Because sin is actually the greatest danger to your life. Much more danger than the suffering itself is producing. Because of where it will lead you and pull you and take you. So we have to face these trials with that courage to say, no, I want to live righteously. Even if everyone else around me seems to be impacted by the evil and doing things in different ways and handling it in ungodly ways, and even if they're doing that against me, I still want to choose to live righteously. So that's my question for us. How are we responding during these times of trials, during these seasons of suffering, during these days of difficulty? How are we responding? And can we say we're persevering, we're maturing? Or do we find ourselves pulled into the temptation of sin? So let's go to James chapter 1. I want to start by reading verses 19 through 22. And this brings me to the title of today's message as we continue this series around Dear God's People. Today I want us to speak about Dear God's People, Listen and Do. It's simple, it's straightforward, it's not that complicated. Listen and do. Let's read verses 19 to 22 and you'll see the truth and the simplicity of this message from James. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Listen and do. It's not a complicated, it's not the deepest theological message you'll ever hear. In fact, if you just read those verses and use a little bit of common sense and let the Spirit move a little bit, you don't need too much more. Now, we're going to go through this and we're going to break it down a little bit because there is some nuggets of truth that hopefully we can open up our eyes to see today. But the message is simple: listen and do. Look at verses 19 and 20 again. James is starting with this plea. It's this loving admonition. Brothers, sisters, you're dear to me. I care about you. All of you, men, women, listen, everybody, this applies to you. It's important. You need to do this. Take note of this. Everyone, today, take note of this. This is critical. This is important for us. It says, to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Now, if we're honest, and this is what James is getting at, the trials that we go through oftentimes produce the opposite of what's really best for us, right? When we're dealing with stuff and we're struggling, when it's been a hard week and it's been, you know, a hard year and people seem to be talking about us, or we've lost our job, or we're struggling in our marriage, all these things, we tend to sort of do the opposite. We tend to be slow to listen, quick to speak, and quick to become angry. Because these trials, these struggles, what they do is they stir up that stuff in us. They stir up those fears, the insecurities, the self-pity, right? The envy, the jealousy, the things that we have. And then it produces that anger. And some of us let it out and just kind of spew it. And others, we let it brew and it comes in there. And then someday it's a volcano and we erupt on people. He's saying we've got to be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Because if we don't, we're going to say things out of that anger that bring hurt to others and to ourselves. We're going to post things on social media that are damaging and impacting and dividing. Because we're responding from the feeling in the moment rather than the truth that we know that is there for us. See, he brings us to this important point of listening. And he's really kind of speaking to it in a couple different ways. I think there's certainly an application for listening in the context of relationships, how we deal with one another. Are we taking time to actually hear and listen? He says, be quick to listen. Like there's an intentionality. Like that should be the first thing you go to, is to listen first before you're talking, before you're letting it turn into emotion. Are you really listening? But see, we know that when we don't listen well, it damages relationships. It brings division. And it brings even levels of deficiency where we're not able to function in ways that we should, in healthy ways. But the opposite of that, when we listen well, right, what does the listening help to produce? It turns us and puts us in a place where we can have deeper understanding. We can have deeper unity, and we're more useful to one another. We can actually give out more of God's love. We can help and support one another. I can encourage you, and I can actually receive more in that same way as well, because we're able to better support one another. So it starts with the examination of how are we dealing with one another. Are we taking time to listen and hear and understand, and not just rushing to judgment, or not just throwing out our thoughts? Are we listening well? And then the other context, which we're going to get into as we go further into this chapter, is he's talking about how well we listen to God's word. Are we actually quick to listen to what the word says? And we're going to get into that a little bit more. Because see, here's sort of, again, there's the kind of these comparisons, right? Being quick to listen and slow to speak. There's also basically the root of it is, are we self-centered, or are we other or God-centered? Because see, the self-centered reaction is to respond quickly and to lash out and to say things and to let the emotion overtake you because you've got your own thing you want to accomplish. Well, I'm going to let them know how they feel. I'm going to get my own revenge. I'm going to make sure that I get this straightened out in my way, in my agenda, rather than what is God's desire, what is his will, what is his agenda. See, that's why it says that human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. When we respond selfishly, we're thinking about what we want, not what God wants. Do we really want to respond and to deal with these trials in ways that bring God's righteousness? What's honoring to him? What cares and so shows our love and concern for others? Or are we just wanting to find what satisfies us in those moments? Let's continue, because in verse 21 it says, therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. See, he's kind of given us here a way to kind of address those challenges. There's going to be trials, and it's going to tempt you to become angry and respond. And so here's some way to set yourself up so that you can be quick to listen instead of quick to speak. So he addresses it in a couple ways and gives them a couple intentional directives. He says, first, you got to get rid of that moral filth. Get rid of that evil. There's this idea of taking it off and rejecting it. If you remember Ephesians chapter 4, verses 22 to 24, it says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. We've got to get rid of, reject, stay away from that fleshly nature that's there, that wants to respond as it's tempted, as it's stressed, as it's tried, as people talk about it, as people say things. You want to respond, but we've got to get rid of that, put that off. And then our minds can be renewed, and we have this new self. And how do we do that? Well, that's the second part of what he says. Look, the word, it says, is planted in you, but you've got to humbly accept that word that offers to save and deliver you. You've got to put yourself, in this case, in a posture to receive and a posture to learn. Think about when you respond out of anger and you're quick to speak, it's a different posture. You're basically telling and demanding rather than receiving and learning from the word of God that's been planted in you. That word that's planted there has a purpose to produce fruit. To produce that fruit, because see, here's the thing, in the midst of this trial, what's the power of the word? Yeah, God can always change the situation and circumstance, but what he's really trying to do through the word is change you. Whether the situation or trial changes or not, the word is there planted in you to change you so that you can bear fruit for his glory. So while it might sound like a simple churchy answer, what do you do when you're stressed, when you're feeling afflicted, when you're in a difficult place, when it's a season of trial and isolation and death and loss in so many ways? What do? You simply turn to the word of God. And you may want a more complicated answer, but there's the truth is here. Life is here. Strength is here. Wisdom is here. But the challenge continues in verse 22, because see, here's unfortunately what happens. It says that we do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. I think even our elementary students can figure this out. Don't just listen to it and let yourself be deceived. Do what it says. See, you can hear the word. You can listen online every Sunday morning. You could listen to your favorite preacher during the week, who may not be me or Pastor Corey. You can, you can look at the picture on Facebook that has the scripture verse. But if you're not doing it, you're a hearer and not a doer. Hey, there were a bunch of hearers, even in Jesus' day. He drew a large crowd. But we know that most of them left and didn't follow him. There were only a few that were disciples that followed him and did what he said. It changed their life. It changed the ways they talked, the way they lived, the way they thought, the things that they ate. It changed their whole life. Because hearing and not doing, as it tells us, is just an act of self-deception. Deceiving ourselves, thinking we're one thing, but we're not. And he gives a further illustration of this as we go on to verse 23 and 24. It says, anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror, and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. So I brought along a little mirror today. Here's the point, because there's a couple different interpretations of this as I was studying this, but I think it really, to me, it seems fairly clear that there's some truth in this example of the mirror. Okay, so you can look in the mirror, and it talks about looking in the mirror with your face, and the roots of the word actually talk about the natural face, the face that you were born with. And it's kind of implying this notion, look, you've had this face all your life. And you're looking at it, and it feels ordinary and simple because you've seen it before. And so when you walk away from it, you're quick to kind of forget about it because it's ordinary and it doesn't have an impact on your life. So in a way, it's really sort of useless. It's unimportant. So he's not making the point here about, oh, we've just got a short-term memory issue. But what he's saying here is when you treat the word like a mirror, you're basically just saying, I'm looking at this and it's just kind of ordinary. It's really useless. It doesn't really apply much to my life. So when I've looked at it quickly and move on, I forget about it because it's not important. Because it's not doing anything significant for me. It's just like a glance in the mirror in the morning, like some of us maybe spend 30 seconds on a scripture, and then we move on throughout the day, and we've basically said it doesn't mean anything anymore. So is that how we are treating the Word of God? We hear it, we may even know it, but in essence, we're basically saying it's kind of useless. Maybe it's, we're really just, either it's unclear, it's not enough clarity to really impact my life, or we're saying it's irrelevant. Because I can't apply it to my situations because I don't do anything with it, so it must not really have a lot of power or a lot of truth. So this is why it's a self-deception of sorts, because we're missing what it really is. Not only is it a self-deception, but for those of us who claim to be Christians and followers of Christ, it's a self-contradiction. For us to say, God, I will receive your salvation. I want to be saved and delivered and transformed, but I don't want to live based upon what you said, what you've told me to do, what you've instructed me to do. I want to choose to do it my own way. I want your salvation. I want to get to heaven. I don't want to go to hell, but while I'm here, I want to do what I want to do. That's a contradiction of disciple and follower. You can't say you want to follow someone and be like them and study under them and you know, imitate what they do if you're trying to just do what you want to do. So then you treat it like, yeah, it's just something I look at casually and move on. But unlike the mirror, the Word of God actually has value. It has significance. And guess what? More than just showing us what's on the outside, it actually shows us what's within. What is in our heart? What are our thoughts? What is our motives? Where is that? How are we pure or impure? What are our desires? What are we devoted to? What are we surrendered to? So it has a clear picture for us of who we are and who we can be. And it doesn't just leave us there, but it's useful because it gives us what we need to apply to all aspects of our lives. Whether we've been isolated for 9 months, whether we've lost a job, whether our spouse is suggesting that they might want to leave us, whatever the difficulty, whatever the circumstance, there's truth of the word for us to apply. And he speaks to that when he goes on in verse 25 and it says, but whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. So there's a few points here. It's like in this one verse, James is kind of giving us a blueprint as believers as to how we can equip ourselves with the Word of God by listening to it and doing it. And what do we receive? We receive freedom and blessing. Let's quickly go through this. He says, look intently. This is that idea of a penetrating examination. It's not just a quick glance at the mirror, but it's a leaning into, a bending down, getting close to, and focusing on, and I'm examining it. I got to get a better look at this. This is what we do when we search the scriptures, when we study the scriptures, when we dig into them and we glean from it and we understand that, yeah, this is not just a great book. But there's richness there, there's truth there that we need to better understand, not just a superficial, you know, oh, I can quote a few things and move on with my life. And then he says that you should continue in it. It's a persistence. You got to keep looking at it, persevering with it. You got to stay close to it. You got to abide with it. You're really living with it. This word is with me. So throughout the day, I'm reading, I'm studying. It's like a regular habitual thing. This is what I do. I need it like I need to eat meals. I've got to stick with it. And then it says to not forget what they have heard. So I'm not treating it something kind of casually. I'm not neglecting it, being sort of lazy with my word that, you know, I put in my 5 minutes today and then I'll pick it up tomorrow. Or maybe it's been 5 days and I'll pick it up again, or 5 weeks and I'll pick it up again. But no, I don't want to forget it, so I'm going to spend time with it. I want to make sure I learn it. I'm going to memorize those scriptures, and I'm going to, you know, ponder them and meditate on them so that I'm ready to apply it when the situations come. Oh, this happened. Okay, let me pull back that word I know that God has put in me, and now I'm ready to apply it. Because see, that's the next thing it says. Because you can read it, as you said before, you can know it, you can hear it, you can listen to it, you can look at it, but you got to do it. He says, is the last one is that you're doing it. You're doing it. You're putting into action. You're obeying. This word is kind of rooted in this idea of you're performing it. You're putting it into place. You're practicing it, right? Like it's game time, and I'm ready to put it into play. I'm applying it to my life. I'm applying it to my thoughts. I'm applying it to my actions, to my words. There's also this notion of I'm submitted to it. This is what governs me. This is what directs me. So now when the most difficult trials comes and those hardest moments comes and you lose people that you don't expect to lose, or you have no money to pay your bills, or whatever it may be, you feel lonely and you don't think you're ever going to get out of this place of depression, whatever it may be, that in those moments I can say, look, I'm going back to what I've surrendered to. And that's where I'm going to find my truth and my strength that I'm going to act upon. And I'm going to make that choice. And what are the results of that? It says that we are then blessed in what they do. We will be blessed in what we do. This blessed to be well off, to receive the joyful benefits and favor of God. True blessedness comes not from escaping the trials, but by obediently doing the word in the midst of the trials. So I'm gonna end there today. And I want us to just think and pray where you are and just meditate with God and allow him to speak to you, because there's a challenge here for us. In the midst of whatever you're going through, maybe it feels like a big trial, maybe it feels like a small trial. As we look and consider how we're living our lives, can we truly say we're listening and we're doing it? I suspect many of you who are listening today on this message, you know a good amount of the word, but are we doing it? Are we walking in it? And look, this is not to say that we do all this out of our own self effort and, you know, energy, but it's, I recognize my weakness, and so I go back to the word, because that's where the Spirit provides me strength, the power to live it out, the power to apply it, to see my thoughts changed, to see my actions changed, for me to be able to live in self-control, for me to be able to live selflessly and love others, for me to be able to live in discipline and stay away from those things that are of my flesh and of this world and not of God. How are we doing with that? How are we doing with that? And have you even made this choice? Those that know God, I hope that we would allow the Spirit to show us those areas where we haven't been doing and we haven't been going to the Word in the way that we need to, that we haven't treated it in that way with that value of how useful and how clear that it is. And some of us, we've never made that choice, perhaps, as you're watching. You've never made that commitment where you say, God, I need your way. I need you to speak to me. I need my life to change. You may realize, like, yeah, you are dealing with anger and stress and all sorts of other things. And if you're honest, you don't really know what to do with it and how to change that. What I'll tell you today is God's not going to take every bad thing away from your life. But he's going to bring himself into your life if you receive him in a way that will change how you can deal with every bad thing, so that you can have that relationship with God that will bring you peace in the midst of trials and will bring you a joy that can't come from an earthly happiness. And he's offering that to you, and he's asking you to first receive that. And your response to do is really just to ask. We said this before service. Pastor Corey talked about God is not like us where we sometimes listen and don't do. But God, he will hear you, and he has already done something about it. He's offered you the opportunity to be restored, to be forgiven, and to come back into relationship with him. So I invite you to do that as I pray today. Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for the truth of your word. I pray, God, more than anything today, that we would hear from you and we would respond. Whether that response for some is a need to surrender, to give their heart and life to you. Some may need to respond by repenting from some of the ways they've been selfish and distracted and consumed with temptations. Others, God, may just need to respond in a way today that says, God, I just need I want to recommit to digging into your word and to longing for it and to applying it to my life. Give me a greater passion and hunger for your word today. I've gone a little cold. I've gotten a little comfortable. I've gotten a little lax. But God, the truth is I need to not just hear it, but I need to do it. Because this is where my power lies. Lord, let that be true. And speak to each and every one, regardless of where they are today. We thank you that you lovingly draw us nearer to you. And that you are gracious and merciful. And so, Lord, we pray that the word of truth today would be heard and it would be applied to our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Pastor Jason. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Lord. My heart is yours. My heart is yours. Take it all. Take it all. My life's in your hands. I just want to encourage you this morning. Thank you, Pastor Jason, for bringing us this wonderful word today. Those of you that have children or have grandchildren that you work with, I want you to just really take this word and just begin to just go over it with your family. Take time at the dinner table today. Take time in just talking about this word, James 1, verses 19 through 22, because it becomes very important even for our young people to understand that the word of God being poured into us is to change us, is to help form us into his image. And so I want to encourage you parents really to take advantage of this time to be able to do that. I love the fact that you know, me and my children have had these conversations, me and my oldest, we've had these conversations about being able to be in the word of God and wanting to have that desire. Everything you talked about, Pastor Jason, my son has mentioned to me, you know, of just this desire to want to do better with the word and want to do better with getting in. And so even what you spoke today is so powerful that it applies to even young people. And so I want to encourage you, just take the time that needs to be taken to get in the word of God around the dinner table, around lunch table, whatever it is, and dig through that word and help them to understand. Let us not only be hearers, but let us be doers of the word. Hallelujah. Very powerful. Thank you so much. So please check out the other announcements that are on our website. We are having a women's event that's coming up this weekend, right? Or coming up next weekend, a cooking event, right? So yes, it's coming up this week. And so ladies, you can check that information out. I'm sure it'll be a wonderful time. Also, just please check on our website for more information. If you need prayer, if you want salvation, whatever the case may be, I praise God. Last weekend, we had somebody that left a message on our Facebook page that wanted prayer. And praise God, we were able to connect with them and give them prayer. So look, we are praying. Hallelujah. You can join us in prayer Monday through Friday at 6 a.m. And I'm telling you, it's a powerful time. Hallelujah. Don't let it just be an idea. Oh, it's a good idea to pray. No, be a doer. Amen. Praise God. That's going to be the new t-shirt. Be a doer. Hallelujah. It's not just great to have intention. We need to do it. Praise the name of Jesus.
All right, so I'm going to leave you with that. Hallelujah. I want to bless you in the name of Jesus. As you've heard the word today, please walk it out in the mighty name of Jesus. Ask the Holy Spirit for help. That's why he's there. Ask the Holy Spirit. He will help you. Amen. Amen. Father, we just thank you so much for this time. Thank you for drawing us together, Lord God, one more time. Thank you for those that have tuned into the Facebook page today. Father, I pray that you'll just bless them in a mighty way, Father. Thank you, Lord God, for keeping us, oh God. May your word continue to grow us, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you. Amen. Thank you for being a faithful giver. If you want to give, please go to www.thesignofthedove.org/give. Amen. You can also give on our Cash App. But we also want to say thank you for being a giver in this ministry. Hallelujah. We're so blessed because of your faithfulness. In Jesus' name, God bless you.